Okay, I'll start by once again quickly just reviewing the structure of the content addressable memory cell. So what we saw there was, we have a regular SRAM kind of a structure, two back-to-back inverters with their respective access transistors and so on. This is the word line, which is used for reading the contents of the cell and writing data into the cell, just like for the regular SRAM, right? And what we have over here is, these are the bit lines, DL and DL bar. When I want to read data from the SRAM, from this RAM, I give it an address, which basically means to activate the word line, and that is done after pre-charging the bit line and bit line bar. And the reading process works exactly the same as what we discussed for the regular SRAM. Writing also the same way. Put the data onto the BL and DL bar and then activate the word line. Right? So now what we need is some additional circuitry which says, supposing I want to find out, I want to answer the question, is this particular data present in any cell in the memory block? Right? What I do over there is, I construct an additional circuitry which looks something like this. So what I have done over here is, there are four additional transistors. I will call it for now this M1, M2, M3, M4. These are just NMOS transistors, nothing else. Right? Regular NMOS transistors forming a sort of a pull down network. They are not really implementing any specific logic over here. The crucial part is, supposing this point is Q and this is Q bar, this is BL and BL bar, right? If Q is equal to BL bar, M1, M4 will pull down the match length. Okay? That is, in other words, Q is not equal to BL. Okay? This, by the way, is repeated across all the cells in the row. Right? So the match line runs across the entire row and is connected to all the cells. What I do when I want to find out if there is a match is, I put the corresponding data on all the BL, BL bars of each of the columns. Okay. When that BL, BL bar are put on the column, the match line, if there is even one mismatch anywhere in that row, that match line will get pulled down. Okay. But if all the column entries corresponding to that particular line are exactly the same as what was stored inside the corresponding cell, then the match line will remain high and will indicate that there is a match in that particular cell, in that particular row. Okay? So going back to the example of where something like this is used, supposing you are trying to implement an internet router, where what you want to do is, you are getting entries which are packets of data to be switched. Okay. The packet contains some kind of a header information which says, this is the IP address to which it needs to be sent. This is the address to which it needs to be sent. and the response that is required is there are many different output ports for this router. I need to know onto which port I am supposed to send the data. Okay, where am I supposed to send the data name? So I store all of that information somewhere in this kind of a content addressable memory. Next time when a packet comes with that, with a particular address, I'll take that address and put it on these bit lines and see whether the match line gets activated. Okay? If the match line is activated, then essentially what happens is, yes, there is an entry corresponding to this. Okay? And that in turn tells me something which I can then use for something else. I can essentially say, okay, there is an entry corresponding to this match line. Now use that particular match line, the index of that match line, to look up in another memory, right, where and what is the data to be stored, which port to send the data to, the packet to. Right, because if I once again try reading out the content of this memory, I am only going to get back the data which I stored, which I already know. But the important point is, this is telling me which match line, which line match. And that can be used to look up in another memory what is the content or what is the data corresponding to this content. Okay? So this is how a match or a content addressable memory can be implemented. NOR of all the match lines will give what you can call a miss signal, right? Which essentially says, if the NOR of all the match lines is low, what it means is that, or rather if the NOR of all the match lines is high, what it means is that all the match lines were low. The only way that can happen is the data that you were looking for is not present anywhere in this memory, and therefore there is a miss. You don't have data present over there. Okay? This can also be used, for example, in a cache for processors, right? What does a cache memory do? Essentially it says, if I am looking for a particular data, I look at part of the address of that data, or I look at the address of that data, and I check to see whether it is already present in my cache memory, or I have to go back to main memory in order to find it. Right? So what we say over there is, if it is already present in the cache, then just take the data from the cache and give it to me. If it's not present in the cache, that is, it's a miss, then I need to go to the main data, main memory. Okay? So you can see how the same thing could be implemented by this mechanism as well. Okay. Content addressable memories in general are quite useful, except that because of all this overhead that you need to have these match lines, you need to have all of this, they are not very common because the content addressable memory by itself is not the end of the story. You also need to take the match line and read out data from another memory block. Right? So for the most part, what you will find is people design compact and efficient SRAM blocks, the regular RAM blocks for storing data. The content addressable part of it is only for specific situations. Okay? Alright. Now, the next kind of use of memory. This is not a memory by itself. It is a usage of something like a memory block in order to implement certain kinds of logic. Okay? Once again, what we are going to do is we are going to use a sort of array structure in order to implement some kind of logic. Okay? And the idea behind it is any Boolean function in general. Can be written in the sum of products form. What is the sum of products form? There will be many terms of the form and all of those terms together are odd together. Right? So there will be something like this. Maybe something of this sort. Okay? This is an example of the sum of products, form of representing a Boolean function, right? In general, any Boolean function can be represented in this form, right? In some cases, it may not be only x1, x2, it might also be some of the signals are complemented, right? This could also be there, right? So in general, what you have is either the signal or signal complement, they are added together to form the min term. Those are then all together to form the final sum of products expression. Okay, so in that way we get a total overall sum of products expression for any Boolean function. Okay, so what we would like to do is there any way by which I can implement some kind of a structure which looks like this, where x1 to xn goes into a set of AND operations. Okay, the outputs of that are min terms which go into a separate OR operation and generate one or more outputs. So what we would like to see is there some way by which I can create a regular structure which essentially allows me to implement something like this in an efficient manner, in a programmable manner, where something like this, I provide a set of inputs, I do some kind of modifying connections or some other switching in that AND area and in the OR area, right? I know that the entire AND area is only going to implement the AND operation. So I would like to see what is the most efficient way in which I can just implement AND of many variables together. Okay, the OR area is only doing OR operations in order to generate output. So for each output, there is one OR operation that finally needs to get implemented. Okay, so the question becomes, how do I do this in a easy to generalize manner? Okay, what I'm going to do is take up a specific example of how we might implement something like a full adder and see how it can be implemented using this kind of a structure. Okay, so the full adder essentially consists of two equations, right? The sum is this term, which is basically the XOR of all the three inputs, and the carry out is AB plus BC plus C. Okay, so in this way both of the terms are already present in the sum of products form. All that I need to do is generate the individual product term, the min term, and from that generate the final sum. Okay, so what we are going to do is see whether there are, and what is, or rather the most efficient or easy to implement way for getting this kind of AND structure. This is usually called the AND plane, and the OR structure, also called the OR plane. Okay, I want to do this such that there are essentially a set of crisscrossing wires, and in between those wires there are just a few connections that I need to make, which will give me the correct functionality. Okay, so what does it look like? Essentially, what one possible way by which we can do this is to say that I'll consider the signal A over here and generate its complement A bar. Okay, B and B bar, C and C bar. Okay? What I want over here is the term, let's say ABC. Okay? Now, if I ask you to essentially put together a set of transistor connections which will allow me to implement this functionality, how would you do it? What are the things that you can think of which will allow you to implement it? We want the output ABC on this wire over here. Right? So, normally what we would say is, if I wanted to do an AND operation, then I would actually need to put transistors in series. Right? I would need to break the wire and put a transistor over there. Right? So that, for example, it would look something like this. Right? Now this is a problem. Why? Because I don't want to break those wires. And not only that, I know that if I have a long chain of transistors in series like that, its performance is poor. Right? Remember the types of ROM memories that we implemented. Right? What are the two types of memories that we had? There was a NOR ROM and a NAND ROM. In the NAND ROM, we had the transistors in series. The problem was, once you have many of them in series, it becomes too long and complicated, performance becomes very poor. What is the alternative? NOR. Okay? So can you think of any way by which you can use a NOR kind of structure in order to implement this ABC functionality? Exactly, right? ABC is equal to A bar plus B bar plus C bar. Okay? Which means that I can now pick up something like this. I will take A bar and say I will put a transistor here. I'll put another transistor here and another transistor here. Okay? So what are those three transistors in blue doing? They are acting as the pull down network. If A bar is high or B bar is high or C bar is high, the output will get pulled down. What do I need for a pull up network? I need some kind of a pull up, a load. Right? Probably the simplest one based on what we have seen so far is a pseudo NMOS kind of a structure, which means one PMOS with its gate grounded. Okay? So what do? We take that over here. Okay? So now, look at this in terms of the structure of the array. Right? What we have is a lot of regularity. We essentially say that the AND operation, the product term, has been created using a NOR gate by taking the inverse functionality. A bar plus B bar plus C bar, the whole bar is equal to ABC. Right? So we can straight away implement something like a NOR gate by doing this. What do we need to do? We essentially just need to make sure that the transistors are put in at the appropriate places. Or alternatively, while creating this structure in silicon, we put transistors everywhere, but we connect them only if required. Right? This particular connection. Right? We can say that that connection which actually makes that particular transistor over there can be put in only if required. Right? In practice, of course, it's not that you will put the transistor and then connect it only if required. You will do some kind of a processing at the mask level itself, at the silicon layout, which makes it easy for you to either attach the transistor or not have it over there as required. Okay? So, in this way the term ABC and correspondingly any other terms as well can be generated. Right? So, for example, if I have another logic block over here and I take what is the expression over here corresponding to this? A bar plus B bar the whole bar. Right? So AB. Right? I just left out the C term completely. Okay? So just the AB term alone can be generated in this way. Like this I can generate all the min terms that I need. Okay? The next question that comes up is what do I need to do as far as the OR plane is concerned? Okay? OR in some sense is even more straightforward. OR is, after all, just not of NOR. Right? So, what I can do is, I can take the min terms that are coming from here. And have another similar kind of a logic structure which says, this is once again a pseudo NMOS NOR. So I have AB plus BC plus CA being generated at the output. Okay. All that I need to do is make sure that from my AND plane I have the min terms corresponding to AB, BC and CA and I OR them together in the OR plane, right, and generate AB plus BC plus CA as the output. Okay. Now the interesting thing over here is generating multiple outputs is also very easy. All that I need to do is have another line over here. This, for example, would be just the term AB. Okay, if I wanted it. In this case, for the full adder, of course, I don't need it, but if I wanted it, then that term AB is directly available to me. Or AB plus BC. Anything which is a sum of the min terms that I have already generated can be directly generated by this OR plane. Okay? So this kind of structure, the overall structure is called a programmable logic array or PLA. Okay? The idea behind the PLA is you are trying to make a structure which is easy to create, which is easy to generate in silicon. You are less concerned about whether this is the optimal mapping in terms of, you are not even bothered too much about whether to do Karnaugh minimization or anything of that sort, Karnaugh map minimization or anything like that, right? Because it will turn out that if you are able to implement something using min terms that are already present, that are already generated for some other purpose, then you are better off using those min terms rather than trying to once again generate a new min term which corresponds to the minimized functionality. Okay? So what you do over here is you just make use of the fact that I somehow need to generate a set of min terms and then add them together or OR them together in order to generate the final output. Okay? Why is it programmable? It's programmable in the sense that the array structure itself can be created ahead of time and kept ready. What I need to do in terms of programming is just decide where those transistors need to go and somehow implement them. Okay? So that is the sense in which it's programmable. It's programmable like a ROM is programmable. You can do it once. You cannot keep changing it while the system is functioning. okay? But during manufacture time, you can program it. You can essentially set it to whatever set of values that you want, whatever minterms and products and sum of products that you want, and generate those outputs. Okay? Now, any time that you have a relatively small number of outputs, let's say 5 to 10 outputs, which are dependent on, again, a relatively small set of inputs, maybe 10 to 20 inputs, something of that sort, right? Maybe even 10 to 20 is quite complicated. Okay, so in other words, when you have a relatively small number of outputs, it is generated as a combination of, once again, a relatively small number of inputs. You can use this kind of structure efficiently. Okay? Now, programmable logic arrays were very popular for quite a while because they were a very useful and interesting way of implementing random logic. What I mean by random logic is something which is just a random combination, not random combination, but some arbitrary combination of inputs. Okay? Arbitrary not in the sense that it's just a, you know, randomly putting together the inputs, but any functionality where you need to create a set of minterms and order them together. Right? Something of that sort could be done reasonably well using programmable logic arrays. Nowadays we have another variant of this, which is a much more advanced version of something similar. Okay? And programmable logic arrays as such are less and less used. They probably still exist but are not very popular. Instead of that, what we have is the field programmable gate array. Otherwise known as the FPGA. Okay. Now, as the name suggests, once again, this is also a gate array. So, in some sense, it bears a slight resemblance to the idea of a programmable logic array. Once again, there is the concept of an array of gates, which can be programmed in order to perform certain functionality. The important addition over here is the field programmability. Okay? Field programmability not in the sense of an electric field, but more in the sense of in the field, once it has been deployed, once it has been put into operation, it can then be programmed. Okay? So, what we are going to do now is take a very brief look at the overall structure of what a single cell inside an FPGA looks like, right? But bear in mind that what I am going to cover over here is just a very, very high level overview. The actual FPGA cells are much more complex, right? And in fact, nowadays are getting even more complex because of more and more functionality being brought into the FPGA. Okay? But the core idea is something like this. You have a logic cell, or sometimes also called a configurable logic block. This typically, not necessarily, but typically looks something like this. These LUTs are lookup tables, okay, which are typically functions of either 4 or 6 inputs, depending on the type of FPGA that you have. Once again, these numbers are arbitrary. 4 or 6 are what is prevalent today, but there is no compulsion that it has to be either 4 or 6. Right? Along with this, there will be some additional functionality, some fixed logic which you can implement if you want to. Flip-flop for implementing the memory part of the system, and usually some multiplexers ahead to basically choose which of the inputs go into the flip-flop. You don't have to memorize this structure. First of all, it's not accurate. Right? This is not exactly what an FPGA lookup logic block looks like. So don't try to sort of memorize this or keep it in mind. This is more sort of indicative of the kind of functionality that is put into a typical modern FPGA. Okay? If you are interested, and hopefully you are interested, otherwise you wouldn't be doing this course. Right? Go and look up the data sheet for an actual FPGA. Right? The most common, or rather the most popular FPGA brand today is from this company called Xilinx. There is another one called Altera, which has just been bought by Intel for some $16 billion, by the way. These are the most popular. Apart from that, there are also Actel, Lattice. There are a few companies that make FPGA. Okay? Most of them have a very similar kind of structure. Most of them follow the same kind of principle. There will be lookup tables, there will be flip-flops, there will be multiplexers that decide which of the inputs go to which flip-flop, which input goes where, and so on. And there will be some additional logic, which usually is done for things like, for example, the carry propagate in a ripple carry adder. There will be some logic that makes that pass. Okay? So all of this essentially becomes one cell. And the overall FPGA itself consists of many such cells. Right? And the wires between them are also programmable. What that means is, for example, it may be possible to take something like this, connect it to this wire, take it over here, and connect it to this. Right? So that you have, for example, a path which leads like this. Okay? So this, in other words, forms a programmable interconnect. Okay? So those are the two main components of an FPGA. There is the configurable logic block, which consists of lookup tables as well as flip-flops, and the connections inside over there can be programmed. And there is the programmable interconnect, which says that in between configurable logic blocks, you can change the connectivity in any manner that you want. Okay, so how do you implement logic functionality inside a lookup table? Supposing I wanted to implement something like y is equal to ab plus c in a lookup table, 4-input lookup table. How would I implement this? Huh? okay? Yeah, so essentially what you are saying is, in this case we have only three inputs, not four, right? So I'll connect three of them over here, A, B, C. Output will be Y. Okay? Now, what you understand by a lookup table, it essentially says that if I want to find out the content of a particular value A, B, C, D, then I write down the value A, B, C, D, whatever it is, look up the corresponding content in a table and read out whatever is the output value that is present over there. That table, in other words, is the truth table of that function. Okay? So what I have is, I'm also going to put down D over there. The important point is, D does not matter. Right? D is effectively a don't care. As far as this particular function is concerned. Right? But as far as the truth table is concerned, it means that we have to write it out fully. We cannot just put a don't care somewhere inside this because there is no concept of a don't care in digital logic. Right? That's only at the Boolean algebra stage. Once you implement the logic, you have to specify it completely for all values of input. So let's say that the input was 0, 0, 0, 0. The output would be 0. AB plus C is equal to 0. 0, 0, 0, 1, also the output is 0, because it does not depend on the value of T. 0, 0, 1, 0, AB plus T, this becomes equal to 1. 0, 0, 1, 1, again it's equal to 1, because it does not depend on the value of T. Right? 0, 1, 0, 0, AB plus T, so AB is still 0, therefore the output is 0. So on, you can just fill up the entire truth table. Right? So what you do is, you take a truth table, in this case there are 4 inputs, you are using only 3 of them, the fourth one you take all possible combinations, you just repeat it. Right? So A, B, C, and whether D is equal to 0 or 1, the same output will be generated. You take all of these 16 values, and you somehow program them into this lookup table. Okay. And from then onwards, that lookup table is going to implement the function y is equal to AB plus C. Okay. Now, how is this lookup table implementation done in practice? That is one of the things which essentially makes the FPGA technology itself important. In previous days, there used to be this concept called one-time programmable FPGA, where essentially what will be done is, as far as the lookup table is concerned, there would be a lot of fuses or fuse wires in the circuit. And the way to program this is essentially to say, if I want a 0 to be present somewhere in one particular place, I will pass a high current through that particular location and burn out the fuse. Okay? Or something along those lines. Right? So blow out a fuse for breaking a connection. There is also another equivalent of that called anti-fuse, where high current would make a connection rather than break it. Okay? So these were the most popular forms of FPGA probably around 15 to 20 years ago. Okay? After that came the concept of SRAM based FPGA, and most of the FPGAs even up to today are based around this kind of technology. Right? Over here what happens is, rather than actually making a physical difference to the system over there that is actually burning out a wire, right? What you do is you just store a 0 or a 1 somewhere in a memory cell. Store the configuration 0 or 1 in memory, and this activates or deactivates transistor with actuators. Okay? So just like in the case of the, supposing you take the programmable logic array, I put a memory element corresponding to the locations of each and every one of those transistors, and I say only if that memory element is 0 or is 1 will the connection to the transistor be activated. How do I do that? I can probably put another transistor in series over there and make it act like a switch, which says when the value over here is 1, this connection is closed. And therefore, this particular transistor is connected to this wire. Okay? So, EEPROM-based FPGAs have the big advantage that they are no longer one-time programmable. They can be reprogrammed. How many times? Indefinitely. Until the entire system sort of burns out or whatever due to overall fatigue in the system, you can keep on reprogramming it as many times as you want. Now, by the way, one interesting thing is many of you might have come across the term burn the design on an FPGA. Right? This fuse and anti-fuse is where that term comes from. You are literally burning something onto the FPGA. You are burning out wires. Right? But in modern FPGAs, you are not burning anything. Hopefully not. If you are burning it, then you are destroying the FPGA. Okay? So if someone says burn the design onto the FPGA, I always get a bit nervous because you are probably going to destroy it. But EEPROM-based FPGAs don't have that. At best, you can say you are downloading the design onto the FPGA. You are not burning anything. Okay? But the terminology still holds. People still talk about burning a design onto an FPGA just because of this background. Okay? Now, EEPROM-based FPGAs are immensely popular. The biggest advantage that they have is they can be reprogrammed. Okay, almost at will, as many times as you want. Every time that you power on the system, you can put a fresh program onto it and get it to behave differently. Okay? One step beyond that is where we say that the EEPROM-based FPGA itself, right? Why go for EEPROM? Can I go for a non-volatile memory that holds the value of the data instead? The same 0 or 1, but can I hold it in a non-volatile data storage? Okay. And that is also currently done usually by using some kind of flash memory. Okay. So, very briefly and at a very very high level, what does flash memory look like? Overall, the idea behind it is based on the physics of the transistor. You once again have some kind of a structure like this, the regular, right, the gate outside. Then you have something called a floating gate followed by another gate outside, right. This one over here is called the floating gate. Now one thing you can see from this is, what this means is that you can no longer make it using the regular technology that is used for CMOS processing, because at the very least there are some additional steps that are required in order to create this floating gate. Okay? So unless the process itself that you are trying to use supports the use of flash memory, it's not possible to create it and use it inside your design. Okay? But if there is such a floating gate and you are able to make it like this, then what is used is by applying high voltage to this gate, you can essentially change the behavior of the transistor. and this is a sort of semi-permanent change in the behavior, right? If you apply a high voltage, then it essentially causes a change, trapping of certain ionic charges over there, which then remain over there until the next time that you once again change it. Okay? Even if power is removed from the system, those charges will remain trapped over there. Okay? What happens in such a situation is, that particular gate now behaves permanently as though it's open or closed. Okay? Even if you have removed power from the system. The one drawback over here is you need to apply a high voltage in order to do the programming. Right? So there are two problems as far as flash is concerned. One is you need a separate process step in order to create it. The second is in order to use it, you need to be able to generate some high voltages for doing the actual programming. Both of those problems are solved, right? Which is why pretty much all the pen drives, everything that you carry around with you, right? Nowadays have fairly large amounts of flash memory on them. Okay, not only is the problem solved, also the density of integration is very large. Okay? So, this is how flash memory works. In the same way, by using this idea of a switch that is either on or off, it can also be used in order to program the behavior of an FPGA. And those are the so-called non-volatile flash-based FPGAs. So nowadays, in other words, the most common forms of FPGAs are the SRAM-based, volatile, and the flash-based, non-volatile FPGAs. Okay? Programmable logic arrays and so on are relatively much less common. They are quite rare to find nowadays. Okay? Alright, we'll stop here for now. Tomorrow I'll be starting on a review of, or rather an overview of what the Verilog hardware description language is all about. Okay? And we'll be giving some assignments. Like I said, during the next week, please focus on your course project and also read one or two assignments that will be given during that time.